Dog is Family on Berks Community Television is underwritten by Answers Pet Food.
Dog is Family on BCTV is supported by Godfrey's. Welcome to Dogdom.
Hi, welcome to our show, Dog is Family, where we celebrate the love between people and their dogs, where we do everything we can to enhance our lives with them, and we think about their mind, their body, and their spirit. So, of course, we get into all kinds of topics with nutrition and health and wellness, fun things to do, and boy, do we have a show for you, because we are really looking at foods again today, folks, and because of such a feeling that food is medicine and what we take in our own bodies and our dogs' bodies really matters for their life and for their longevity and the best that we can do. I've got a wonderful two people here today to talk about that to you. So I'm welcoming them, David and Diana Vogel. Are you there?
Yes. Hi.
Hi, guys. David and Diana have an interesting personal story, and you know Godfrey's, and you know folks that are viewing, that we really look at the people who are doing things with passion, with knowledge, and changing the way we live with our dogs. These guys are going to talk about that. They are from Small Batch. Now that's going to tell you something already about the foods that they do, and they have a very interesting story. I'd love you to bring folks up to date on who you are, why you're here, how you got here, and then we're going to get into all the cool stuff that you guys are doing. Lead off.
Love it.
Thank you. Thank you for having us. Really excited to be here. This is what we, you know, have been doing for a really long time. So we're constantly talking about pets, our pets and other pets in our lives, and pet food.
Yes.
That's our life. So
yeah. And we got started in the early 2000s. We both actually worked in the pet industry in different facets. And we were in San Francisco. We were
the epicenter of everything, San Francisco.
Yeah, we're new stuff, foods. Yep.
There was this food renaissance going on with humans. You know, it was called slow food, knowing where your food came from, sourcing, you know, eating as much local food as possible. And since we had this knowledge of the pet space and all that, and then Diana adopted a cat and we started feeding
this
it.
Blue.
We started feeding it the food that I was manufacturing for another company, and he did not do well on it. And so that's where that aha moment came from. So we read a bunch of different books, because we were doing, so the food we were making was based off of Dr. Richard Pekarin's Natural Health for Dogs and Cats.
Yes.
And for some reason, our cat Blue just didn't do well on the diet. And I think Dr. Richard Pekarin's amazing, and I think his book is amazing, and it's been great for me and hundreds of thousands of other people. But since our cat was having a hard time on the grain with raw meat, because that's kind of his, you know, it was barley and then raw meat and vegetables and supplements, he just wasn't doing well. So we went hardcore raw, like Dr. Ian Billinghurst. Give your dog. So grinding meat and bone and organ meat, and he thrived. And so
we were able to see the difference right away. His teeth, his muscle mass started, you know, developing correctly, and his fur, and he just became a beautiful, he went from a silly little feral cat from the shelter to like a thriving, beautiful, healthy cat.
He's still with us today.
17 and healthy and happy. So what a cool story. You were probably eating healthy too at the time, if you were foodies. Did you tell me that at one point? Like you were really into food. So
we were.
Yes. So the community that we lived in, I feel like truly inspired us and put us on the right path to where we are today. Like David mentioned, there was this, you know, slow food movement renaissance happening around us. And for us, one of the biggest inspirations was a market in our neighborhood called Buy Right Market, where Sam, the owner, feels like he's creating community through food.
Yeah, that's good.
Yeah, and that's essentially what he was definitely educating people around in that neighborhood and anyone who really was coming to the neighborhood visiting tourists about local farms, the importance of local farms, the importance of local ranches, the importance of grass-fed beef, pesticide-free.
Sustainable fisheries.
Yes.
Awesome.
So if you ever took a bit, if you ever visited his store and you caught him there, anyone in his store, they would go above and beyond to explain, you know, the importance of being real quality food.
And it was a major inspiration for us as people. And so you fast forward to small batch being conceived, it was how do we inject these principles and philosophies into pet food, and how can we do this?
And we knew that the people around us wanted a healthier option than what was presented in front of them through, you know, different pet foods
stores
and pet stores. And I was a dog walker, and I managed a few pet stores, and I just knew I connected with, you know, the pets that I was taking care of and seeing, and sometimes I had to administer medication, and kind of an expert in different, you know, illnesses and conditions through just my customers, those type of customers. And when we came up with, when we started making our own food for our pet, I started asking these people, like, hey, if do you want to try this food that we're making for Blue? And, you know, we can make something special. We were into making special diets.
Yeah, we did custom diets.
You were custom. Okay.
Yeah, it was very grassroots. It's growing organically at glacial speed, like slowest thing you could ever imagine. But
And you peddled your food to markets, David, the store you took.
I had a cooler. Some of our stores were walking distance, and so I had a cooler that had wheels, and then it became two coolers stacked on top of each other. We would
and I'm known to deliver my bike
on her bike. We would
so awesome
the BART or Muni, which is the public
BART of Maine.
We'd go down to the ferry plaza to the farmer's market, get beef from Marinson Farms, lamb from Prather Ranch. You know, everything was really doing something. It was amazing. It was magical.
Yes.
And so we've grown it organically. I mean, like where you're at today, and I will tell you, my boys, my golden retrievers eat small batch, you know that. And just seeing growth from passion, that's what we're all about here too. It's like, you start with a story, you start with knowledge, you start feeding it and people learn. So where are we at today? And talk a little bit more about those principles. You've mentioned sustainable, locally sourced. Is it hard to find that sourcing? And as you grow, like, tell people a little bit about what's in that the foods for dogs and cats. It's there for both folks that are out there watching. Like, how do you find all that, balance that, and source that? Just talk a little. It's got to be kind of challenging. And then, you know.
I like to say, as we've grown, you know, as we used to source everything within the state we manufactured and sold our food in, which
that
was
is.
Then we moved to Oregon. To me, my food shed grew. I was able to start sourcing from the Pacific Northwest.
Right.
And as we expand to different states, I look into those regions for food that's local to that state. And we have a couple different manufacturing facilities throughout the United States. So we try to utilize local food, local to those.
Oh, that's great. That's awesome.
Important things for us is the bonds and the relationships that we have created and established very early on with a lot of the sourcing.
Yeah, the connections that we've made.
The farms and ranches that we've made.
They're long-lasting. I mean, there's so
like we know each other's families. We've gone out to dinner. We've had conversations where, like, we cry and we share contacts and we
folks that are watching. That's not the big farm machines, and that's not the meats that you're buying in other cases, maybe in other dog foods. This is, they know who these folks are. They set these relationships up. So that's what's powerful for me as a dog parent and a business owner. That's what we look for. We want that.
And that cycle of bringing everything full circle, right? The land, the animals, the people that are connected together, helping each other thrive.
Yeah, really.
And set out to be authentic. That was one of our main goals. Like no stock images, no greenwashing. It's got to be authentic. And I think over the years, even though we've become bigger, I think we've gotten better. And we've had our trials and tribulations. Don't get me wrong. Most of them have to do with, you know, processing and things that are sometimes beyond our control.
Yeah, and that's hard with all the safety issue. You got to watch your processing. Is there anything to talk about? Are you HPP'd? I'm not sure if the folks know HPP.
No, our raw is true raw. We do have a stringent protocols of pathogen mitigations, but we're not against or for HPP. We don't think. We don't have anything bad to say about HPP. Right. We just choose not to do it. We think there's a better way
We've operated this way for this many years without HPP. So it's been just, you know, part of that process where we haven't, I feel like we are flexible with, making changes as we see fit. But for the time being, this is what's worked for us. And we feel like what's helped us is the impeccable sourcing.
Yeah.
You start off
with quality.
I mean, we were in a situation 2 years ago where the facility we operated out of,
we temporarily had to.
We were forced to HPP.
Remember that.
It became a facility-wide protocol because of other things that were going on there with the FDA. Sure. And we saw how much it changed the food. And that was another.
That right. Did you really?
It just obliterated the food. I mean, all this great sourcing and great, we don't use mechanically separated meats. That is a criteria for us. We don't believe in them.
Tell people what that means.
Mechanically separated meat, or otherwise known as mechanically deboned meat, is they just take a lot of like the bony parts of the carcass and they put them through a grinder. And they separate the meat from the bone.
So it's all the rendered parts from all the choice cuts.
And it's basically a very popular additive. It's cheap, but it's full of bacteria. If you use it, you better HPP.
Okay. So that's good, folks. Okay.
Yeah, but it's so when it arrives to you, it's this. Do you remember pink slime?
Oh yeah! Don't turn my stomach.
It's like
the human meat market. Yeah.
It's pink slime.
That's what you saw changing.
So they do it with chicken, turkey, duck, beef. They do it with everything. And we set out early on because as we grew, some of our, some people came at us like meat brokers, like, hey, you should be using this. And I looked at it. I'm like, this is gross. I would never put this in my food. So
I still get calls from meat brokers on my cell phone because they have, our personal information.
Oh, no, that's not good.
But it's another world for sure. You get a lot of unsolicited information about other companies that are using certain foods. Yeah. And for me, I'm like, I don't want to know.
I don't want to know what he says. Well, I need to know, but I don't want to know.
Yeah.
And so when we were subjected to HPP, we saw our food just get stepped on and stepped on and stepped on. Okay. Where it looked like pate, like it didn't have particle definition.
Yeah.
Further process, each process that you put the food through just changes it even more so.
And we try to be minimal.
We try to be very
minimal. And you could talk about high pressure processing folks that are out there that they don't understand it. And they're not on it. And a lot of food companies say it's fine, but chemical composition, nutrition value, right?
Sorry, yeah. Like I said, I think it's amazing technology. There's probably a better way to get to HPP that we need to figure out, or someone.
That makes sense.
Yeah.
Fermentation might be one of those.
But the problem with HPP is you grind, you mix, you chub, you send it to an outside HPP facility.
Then it comes back.
Gets HPP.
Back. All that handling is going on.
Oh, it's just
moving around so much.
Too much.
And if you're thinking about fresh and you're thinking about, minimally processed, that's not it, folks.
So we're trying to lay the groundwork on where we can figure out where quality is and where we're going to go and align our,
like you said, fermentation. There's other things out there, like there's probiotic strains that love to attack salmonella, that love to attack E. coli. There's bacteriophages that love to, there's all these different things. we also process at 26 degrees.
The temperature control.
Which is a bit... very difficult to do. Most people process at about 35 or 40.
Yeah.
So, I mean, we control it. Our food never goes above 29 degrees in the entire process.
Wow, that's awesome. That's awesome. You're ahead of
it. Makes it hard and cold and difficult, but...
prohibits bacteria growth.
Yes.
Yeah, for sure. Okay, that's awesome. And in the composition of the food, you're not meat, bone, and organ. You include vegetables, right?
We do.
And is your balance, is it like 80, 20, 10 or 80?
So yeah. For dog, most of the diets are 98 and then 2.
Wow.
So, or no, 88. I'm so dumb.
I know. I'm dumb too. No, I know. So here, I know this, but my head's like.
I know. So it's 88.
Sorry, David.
88 meat, 2% supplement, and 10% produce.
Yes. Gotcha. Okay.
That's dog. And then cat is, the only vegetable inside cat is dandelion greens.
Oh, nice.
For dandelion. So it's, I mean, essentially 98% meat, 2% supplement, and a little bit of dandelion
greens. We use produce and whole food source supplements to, fill in the vitamin, mineral, content.
Yep.
The fiber and using these sources.
Yep.
So we don't use it. It's strategic, we're trying to add.
It's not filler.
And it's not filler.
Yeah.
We're using Nature's Bounty to help us with, making it complete and balanced.
And we've tried to keep it really simple. And it's funny because I think we were maybe ahead of our time because before now, like there's this big movement of what's in the bowl and it's like, yeah. A patty and an egg and a
yes.
There's so many things. So and when we set out, I go, we're gonna keep it simple because back then, it was mostly like someone would put an egg on it or like put some yogurt on top or we knew people added stuff even if it was completely.
Okay. We wanted to have a little space, so knowing we're giving ourselves a little bit of room because we knew people were likely to add some things.
Okay.
To
Because we baby our, yeah, they baby their pets. They're like, oh, you need a little bit of this.
Or you have some extras, We have chickens, so I often feel compelled to add some egg and the egg membrane.
Yeah, I do it, some other things on top. And it's whole foods. Instead of a synthetic vitamin mineral mix that people want to throw in that bowl, synthetics over time are not good. So let's get the whole foods going. Now tell us, for me as well, in helping folks at Godfrey's, looking for foods that maybe they don't want to feed raw. And you came up with what I love is your method of doing lightly cooked, complete and balanced fresh foods for dogs and cats. So tell us about the methods and how that came to be. And I think it's fabulous.
I'm excited.
So
we're both are excited to talk about it.
I mean, so
I love this segment of the market. I do.
Yeah. I do too.
Yeah. And so it was inspired by some of our raw friendly vets that love and sell our food. And they came to me and said, David, and some of them came to Diana and said, Diana,
my own personal vet.
We need a alternative to raw because some dogs don't do well on it as they get older or they have an autoimmune thing.
Some pet parents are just not
going to feed raw.
They're not ready for raw.
Nope.
They want a healthier option. And we want to see all those wonderful ingredients in the raw in a cooked form for sensitive tummies, for older dogs that just have trouble, doing raw. Or are those pet parents that are just like not ready to leave, a cooked food, but not exactly want to do kibble, we just want like that organic, that, sustainably raised, that humanely sourced meat in this form.
And we thought we were going to have to reinvent the wheel. And we've done this with other products where, we think we have to start over from scratch. And then we looked at each other and said, we have an amazing formula already that's tried and true. People love it. Why don't we just sous vide it and see how it comes out? And it came out great.
Smells great.
Beautiful.
Oh yeah. And it's, and we're trying again, like always trying to get better. And we're trying to perfect the process. We've had some, bumps in the road.
Bumps in the road for sure.
Because you're going through a second process. You have to sous vide it, come back and form it. Cause we wanted to put it in a slider.
I love the sliders. Yeah.
That's nice. Yeah. So, we're trying to figure out a way to, be as minimal as possible.
Yes.
So hopefully you'll just see it get better and better.
So we've had some texture issues for sure. Just trying to perfect it. We know a lot of people are adding it almost like a can substitute. It's people that like to add canned food into their drip kibble. And so we hear that from a lot of people. You know, there's different ways of feeding it is what I hear.
And we're going to be coming out with cat soon, mm-hmm. Lightly cooked cat. And because our cat steals our dog's lightly cooked. And we're like, he loves this stuff.
He loves it.
So,
yeah, he's hooked.
Yeah, but it's we're really happy with the product.
I ran it past before we launched it. I ran the ingredient profile past my own personal vet, who's a big Rava advocate. She's constantly advocating for Rava. She's got those like pit bull clients, some dogs that just can't, or some.
Can you define
to be?
I think we're having a connection
issue. We're having a connection issue. Can you hear us, Barb?
Sorry, I don't know why. It's probably on my end.
Is that better?
I'm here at the shop. I should have probably gone into the studio. So I don't know. Keep trying.
Now, so you wanted to explain.
Okay.
You want to? Yeah. Yes. Yeah, so
why gently cooking in low temp matter?
For a long time.
Yes, it's slow and low. It's so basically it's cooked in a water bath. It's in a sealed package, so there's no leakage and no water can get in. And it's brought slowly up to temperature, and then it's held at temperature for about 5 minutes for the kill step, is what they call it, or lethality. And then you have to bring it back down. So these are USDA Appendix A and Appendix B, and you have to follow it so you don't get botulism, basically. It's like canning food at home. Essentially.
Yeah. Oh, okay. You can find it that way. Yeah.
That's like the Cliff Notes version. Yeah.
I think people, that's enough for them. They don't need to get into the science, but that's it. You're doing it safely. The ingredients, the nutritional value remains higher.
When our labs came back on our cooked, the only things that we saw diminished slightly were a couple minerals. So we added those in a chelate form, which are natural. They're not synthetic. Some people at first were like, what are you doing this for? Because they never saw a mineral or a vitamin on
added
it.
Added to any of our foods.
But we looked around for natural sources and we found
best
them.
Option.
And I mean, if you knew the amount we had to add, it's so small. It's
very small.
That it's like 7/100ths of a pound of this powder.
Oh my goodness. Okay.
Yes.
Okay. It's insane. But just to meet the level.
Just to meet the level, to make sure
that makes sense.
Everyone was getting proper nutrition.
We try to show people like medallions. We call it medallions, sliders. And it's like going to the bar and having your beef slider appetizer on the menu. Like they put that nice little patty in that little roll. And it's so easy to feed. You just can thaw it out very quickly. Folks that want to do better, it's just on the spectrum of people viewing here today. You're going from your dry kibbles of all kinds of grades all the way through here. And I always ask, where are you willing to feed when you're coming in here? Are you back here? Can we move you to fresh? And the implications of going to fresh. So you can, you also have some logs that might make it a little more economical for people.
Lens.
Same food, right? Same thing.
Yeah, it's more stripped down. I'm not sure if you carry the blends.
We have a few, because remember I was talking to you about using that for some dogs that needed a really sensitive, limited.
Oh, I think we talked about that.
Yeah.
So those are really for the DIYers out there that like to make their own food.
Or the really hardcore raw food feeders that have been doing it for like 25 years.
Yeah, that's old school raw.
Yeah, they want to create their own balance
And to be honest with you, it's my cat's favorite food is the blend.
Okay.
He wants very little added to his food. And that's kind of, 17 years. And
that's awesome. And no kidney disease. No kidney disease. Nothing.
Nothing. No. His lab is always
no kidney.
Our vet is always like, this is always what I want to see.
Oh, that's beautiful. Like small
cat. Yeah, yeah, he's
beautiful. I wish, usually he like storms the room.
Yeah, this is usually his hangout.
But you know, he's busy. He is a cat, so he's probably, he was up all night, so he's probably sleeping.
So funny. Oh my gosh, I love it.
Yeah, he likes to hang out with our 7-year-old. He actually sleeps with him every night.
Yeah, it's really
cool. Oh, that's neat. Oh, yeah. That's really neat.
Yeah.
Well, I'm just looking, your story is just amazing. I see pictures of people that are working with you in the farms and where you're headed. Now, the meat proteins, you're doing like porks and all kinds of meats in the raw. And then in the gently cooked right now, you're working with chicken, beef, and turkey.
Yep. Yeah. And there's more coming.
Yeah, I mean,
we just tested duck.
Yep, good.
So we're going to start testing the novel proteins.
Alternative proteins. Okay. So good for, you know, hypoallergenic,
yes,
and sensitive to meat, allergies, whatever. And we're constantly like, come on, we need some other protein options in the lightly cooked, and we need bigger options too.
Yes, somebody else was saying that too. Can they make them bigger? Like bigger? I don't know.
And the last year and a half has been really difficult with supply chain, production, labor issues. So we've been slow to roll out new products just because it's been difficult. So
just do what you do the best you can do, and you do. So another topic, I think when people hear it's human grade, and in the pet food industry, folks, like human grade versus feed grade. I mean, like this is huge. This is the grade that people would be eating. So that's another thing I think is important. And one of the things I think is awesome for you guys that you actually went to that Truth About Pet Food with Susan Thixton, which is some of the resources that have been out there for people to look at, is this a good food? Why does she like this? Why would they be there? It's impressive to you, isn't it, to be listed and to be selected. You had to go through a lot of work, though, to have your processes.
She does her research. She puts it through the ringer.
Which is so important, because who's advocating? You know, who's pet food, there's such a gray area.
Oh, yeah.
Pet food.
We always say there needs to be some ingredient police, because
definitely.
A lot of people claim a lot that may not be true. And we're the kind of people that are like, I'll call the police on myself, because
it's easy to make claims and harder to back them up. And Susan has been amazing. I mean, and just the confidence and the boost and just, you know, allowing parents to get on the right path, or, you know, she makes the roadmap of you know, how to choose food so much easier. And we're so grateful for that.
Yeah. And it's,
we're always like, yes, let's connect.
Get her what she wants.
All the information that she needs. Let's give her receipts.
We give her so much. I mean, we'll send her actual invoices from our meat, you know, our ranches, and to show her like, this is real. This is not a greenwash kind of company.
Right. This is something that I always tell customers. Call if you're questioning something, if you're not sure, first, you know, let your gut instinct guide you, you know, because you have a pretty good idea. And the next is call companies, ask questions. Yeah. Get information from them, and then take it from there. You know, ultimately you have to sometimes trust people and know that they're and feel like they're doing the right thing and trust that. But ask questions all the time. And we're always like open to our customers. Hey, we're an open book. Call our customer service gals, because they love to talk about ingredients, and we love to talk about ingredients.
Oh, do they like to do that? Do they answer?
Yeah.
I think there's a lot of pride, like not just with the you know, owners and founders, but there's pride throughout the entire organization. I mean, sometimes it feels like they're fundamentalists to us. They don't, they're so prideful. They put us in check.
That's good though.
Yeah. Our team is awesome. Yeah. Our sales team is amazing. They are incredibly committed. They're not just out to sell.
Doing a job, yeah.
Make a difference. Yep. Like excellent. Our salespeople are super passionate about health. They're super passionate about ingredients. They're super passionate about pets. And they keep us on track too. You know what I mean?
Accountability.
They're emotionally invested in the company, and it's like, I mean, it's a beautiful thing. I mean,
we're a family. We're truly a family.
Excellent.
And yep. it's so we're forever grateful.
Yeah, we always like to say that nobody works for us, they work with us. And
excellent.
That's our philosophy.
Yeah. But our customer service gals, yeah, we have two now, and they love helping pet parents transition into raw. They like giving them the right information, the right tools, and putting them in the right, you know, path. Always have great suggestions on how to, like, you know, make either if you want to build your own raw or if you want something easier. We're always open to these conversations, and both gals and I love research too. So we're constantly like looking up information, looking up, you know, ailments and situations so that we can try to put up a better, you know, put together a better plan. We're also, we love connecting pet parents to vets that we know are good, you know, partner, nutritionist. So we love, you know, we get excited about helping and like how we can make a difference, whether it's like food, you know, whether it's with our food or another food, because it may not work out. We want to find the right thing.
Yeah. And a lot of customers come to us because, as you know, a lot of vets are anti-raw. So they come to us with a lot of questions, like they're being scared into a food they don't want to feed.
Yeah.
Diana.
And they're ultimately just looking for that confidence of like, I know there's a better way, but I'm really scared. How can I do this? And so we're just always open to giving them as much information so that they can make their own decisions.
Yep. You know, exactly.
Yeah, and we love working with stores like yours.
Love
that
it.
That really dedicates that part of education.
Yes. You know,
just selling products for the sake of selling
them. We're not here for.
No. And for me, you know, working in pet stores before, it was so important to know what I was selling and to be like really knowledgeable in what I was selling, because you can sell something and that customer may come back and have a horrible experience with that product because it wasn't the right product for them, right?
Yes.
So you want to have that part of education is so important, and it's something that we're putting a lot of time into. Our sales staff does an amazing job with like
trainings
and orientations.
Excellent.
And they also have training videos.
Yeah, training videos now, yeah, that are available for if they don't want the person one. But yeah, I think
yep. Oh, I think we do have to wrap up. I could talk to you for hours.
I know. We should interrupt it.
Let's do more. I know. I want to talk about everything. I loved having you here. I know how busy you folks are. I have another young lady going to talk about CBD for Pat. So that's how exciting that one is. Yes. So any final thoughts you want to, any quick one? And then how they find you is on your website, Small Batch
website. People can check in smallbatchpets.com. Also on Instagram, we do a lot of cool stuff on Instagram. So Instagram is smallbatchpets as well. And yeah, they can call us directly as well.
You usually get one of us on the phone. I mean, we're still
awesome.
Yeah.
So thank you so much. We can talk forever. And enjoy your day. I know it was hard fitting it all in. So
No. Thank you.
Thank you for having us. You're doing. Stay committed, please.
Yeah. Thank you.
We will. Thanks for having us.
Okay. Yep. Bye.
Have fun, Shelby.
Bye, Shelby. Yeah. Bye. Hello.
Shelby, are you there? I'm so sorry.
Dorgan's Family on Berks Community Television is underwritten by Answers Pet Food.
Dog is Family on BCTV is supported by Godfrey's. Welcome to Dogdom.
Hey, folks, thanks for sticking with us. We had some technical difficulties, as you know, as we got started. So we're a little late. So we're going to get right to our second topic, which is CBD hemp for dogs and cats. And I have Shelby Flinn here. She's a nutrition education manager for Pet Relief, and she's going to do some general educating and then how to identify hallmarks of quality. Hi, Shelby, take it away.
Hi, thank you so much for having me. I loved catching the end of Small Batches interview. Our co-founder here at Pet Relief is actually good friends with them. And when I transitioned to raw, I was turned on to Small Batch, and there's a lot of parallels there in, you know, quality and education. So yes, you're carrying some amazing brands over there.
We want the committed people to stay that way. And just, I think, do some educating. You know, people come in, they want CBD hemp, but it's the plethora of qualities is all over the map. Mm-hmm. What does CBD do in general? How does it help? And then how did these folks find quality? What are hallmarks of quality? And then, you know, tell them.
Yeah. So they have really focused my whole position here at Pet Relief on education, because we know everybody knows what CBD is now these days, but what is it really? You know, what does it entail? What does it do? And so, you know, education is key, because at the end of the day, everybody just wants to feel safe in the products that they're giving their pets. And so CBD is derived from the hemp crop, which is, yes, technically cannabis, but it is very different than its cousin crop, marijuana. So hemp is high in CBD, low in THC, THC being the component that would give that psychoactive feeling. And at the end of the day, we don't want our pets having that psychoactive feeling either. It's just not the goal. But there are so many benefits from having hemp involved in our bodies. And really, any being with a spine can benefit from having CBD, because any being with a spine has what's called an endocannabinoid system, which is really the major soundboard between our brain and any functioning system that we have. And so CBD allows us to turn what usually only works as a one-way street into a two-way street. So it's basically finding a natural form of homeostasis between all of those functioning systems. So we hear of it, you know, helping a lot with calming within the nervous system, or helping manage discomfort within the muscular system. I mean, CBD is really overlooked a lot of the time for allergies, because it's a awesome boost for the immune system. I actually take Pet Relief every day. I trust, I know the brand, as I'm sure there are so many other great brands out there. But like Small Batch was saying, you know, we do need ingredient police out there, because with it being such an unregulated space, I think a lot of people were trying to come in and get their piece of the pie, and not really having our pets or even humans' health in mind at the end of the day. You know, that's kind of the toss up with a lucrative business. But, you know, for when you're looking to consider a CBD brand, and it's really important to identify a few things, you know, and that quality is huge, because to be honest, I mean, anybody can buy CBD anywhere these days. I mean, gas stations are selling it, and you should not be getting your CBD there. Sorry. Yeah. And especially, you know, when you're buying it for yourself as a human, you know, that's going to be very different in how it reacts in your pet's body as well. So, you know, identifying where the hemp is being grown is huge, and knowing the quality of the soil beneath it. So what a lot of people don't know is that hemp is known as a phytoremediator. So 9 times out of 10, its sole purpose in being planted is to just suck up and absorb toxins from beneath the soil. So it's really important that, you know, the quality of the ground that you're growing it in is clean, because you don't want it pulling up heavy metals and toxins and pesticides that would carry over into the end product. Because I know a lot of people are using CBD for their pets as most of the time a reactive approach. You know, they're looking to fix something or to support some ailment that their pet's experiencing. And if your pet's already sick, you don't want to put more of that into their bodies. And so, you know, there's a lot of different types of profiles too. You know, by now, a lot of our consumers might have heard of like a full spectrum or a broad spectrum or a CBD isolate. And, you know, it's very similar to, you know, let's talk about full spectrum, kind of talking about it as like a football team. You know, that's our entire team. The hemp crop includes 100 cannabinoids. CBD is just kind of the main one leading the pack, if you will. So you have other cannabinoids and flavonoids and terpenes that all have benefits to bring to the table on their own. And so CBD is kind of like our quarterback. Terpenes might be our offense. You know, our flavonoids might be our defense. And when you start using like a broad spectrum, you start eliminating a lot of those cannabinoids. So you're shrinking that team. And then if you're isolating the molecule, that's like putting a quarterback out on the field by itself, saying, go get him.
Wow. Interesting enough.
Yeah, all of those profiles work very differently within our bodies. And so we believe, and, you know, based off of the research that we've done, and again, we've been around for the last decade. So we have, you know, explored all of the different research that's been out there. And so we believe in using a full spectrum. And, you know, a lot of the time that's going to give you a more consistent and effective, you know, result. And so also extraction, you know, how are we taking a crop and excreting oil from it to give us, you know, a tincture, or adding that oil into a baked good or into a topical, you know, it can be extracted in a lot of different ways. And so something to be wary of is the price point that you're paying for. You know, if it's really, really cheap for you and what you're purchasing, you also have to think about it. Well, you know, what's the cost for that retailer to buy it? And what's the cost for the manufacturer to make it? And how are we driving down these price points so low? You know, again, it could be coming from, you know, maybe a sketchy source of hemp that then has been extracted through, let's say, you know, ethanol or acetone or butane. I mean, it sounds scary, but those are really not unheard of methods of extraction. So, you know, we have primarily used CO2 extraction over the years, which is just pressurized air at low temperatures. So it gives you a no chemical residuals are left over in that final product. But now we've looked into even more innovative ways to give us a more efficacious result. And so something called Terpex is something that we've been using. But, you know, it's really important to kind of look at all of those avenues, and then at the end of the day, how easy is it for you to, you know, identify how much CBD is in that bottle? Because at that point, how much are you going to administer? If you don't know how much is in the bottle, then how do you know how much you're administering? And so reputable companies should have third-party testing, you know, something that shows you the potency, something that shows you the heavy metal test, the microbial test, the residual solvents test, which is how we're going to know how it's been extracted. So there's a lot of moving parts to it. So that's why it's really important to shop at, you know, stores like Godfrey's that really do the due diligence and the research for you as a customer to get a good product into your pet's bodies. And so again, you know, a lot of people use it as a reactive approach, but one thing, you know, I love having a platform to even be able to reach so many other people. You know, don't look at this as a medicine or a drug. You know, look at it as an everyday vitamin or supplement for your pet too. You know, as humans, we really focus on diet and exercise and supplements to prolong our health and our lives. Same thing for our pets. So, you know, shopping with a company and feeding a raw diet like small batch is huge. You know, one perk out of, you know, COVID is that a lot of people were working from home. They were able to get out and stretch their legs with their dogs, so getting more exercise. So let's talk about supplements. You know, hemp is a real, and again, based off of what type of hemp that you're using, again, full spectrum is what we recommend. But again, it's a great support to the immune system. It's also a really awesome response to our inflammatory system. So most diseases stem from inflammation. So keep it a natural anti-inflammatory in the system. And then hemp also acts as a neuroprotectant to really help protect everything going on and help slow down that aging process.
When the neurological system.
Like, exactly. Fine. So totally fine to give to, you know, dogs or kittens as young as 6 months, you know, because at that point, their internal organs have fully developed. They can process everything appropriately. And now it's an everyday general maintenance kind of supplement for your pet. So instead of waiting till your pet is 8 years old and now looked at as an old dog, no.
I know. No. Yeah.
You know, start them young. It's not like we, you know, feed our children, you know, McDonald's every day until, you know, they're, you know, renal failure at 8 years old. No, you know, we try and instill that lifestyle and those healthy habits early on. So something to think about.
Yeah, no, that's awesome to think about it as I'm a new dog mom, folks that are watching. You know, we've always had our Goldens. We just have a new puppy again, and we will be adopting, I know, in the future. Today, now it's a puppy. And we were thinking, we talked to one of your folks there too about that. And I know Reed recommended starting at 6 months with him for general health. I find hemp and CBD oils mysterious because it knows where to go in the body for wherever the body needs it. I feel like it, you know, if it's a thunderstorm anxiety or if it's a spinal, or it's just like goes where it has to go. How is that magic happening? It's
the endocannabinoid system. Let's say that a pet's having a seizure, right?
Yes.
Basically what's happening is that endocannabinoid system is firing off neurons on that one-way street to both the nervous system and the muscular system. So really our bodies are only allowing us to receive that messaging, which then tells us to panic, convulse, seize, whatever. And then by activating a full spectrum hemp, it allows that one-way street to turn into a two-way street. So before, when we were just receiving those messages, now it allows us to better block and manage and stabilize that miscommunication. So again, that's happening with all of our systems at once. So one of our customer service reps always talks about it as, you know, a symphony. You know, if when things out of tune, we'll find better balance in that sound and another, you know, part of that symphony, you know, so it's just helping us find that balance. So, you know, and again, a lot of the time too, some people are like, well, I'm not really seeing anything drastic. Right. And what you were saying is it's a little mysterious. It's kind of like vitamin C within our bodies, you know, when we don't take it, we're not like, whoa, vitamin C. It's just, we know the good that it's doing. And then maybe we take some time and don't take that vitamin C. And then we kind of feel a little maybe more crummy within, you know, our immune systems.
Yeah.
And so it's a bit of a silent worker. And so sometimes we'll talk to customers who maybe just weaned their pets off of, not weaned, but took their pets off of our products. And then all of a sudden they're like, wow, it was making a huge difference. And so again, it's just, it's maybe not what you'll see in those results, but it's what you're not seeing anymore. You know, maybe they're a little bit more spry to get up, or, you know, their appetite is changing because maybe they were in some pain and we didn't know. And now it's helping better balance that pain, you know, communication. And so now all of a sudden they're eating more. And so it's cool to see and hear a lot of those different areas that, you know, our customers are really finding, you know, success. And so being part of the company for the last 4 years and really seeing this industry grow, it's been crazy to see a lot of those things and still have those loyal customers and loyal retailers that have just always believed in our brand. So we appreciate that.
Well, it was always a brand. I know when I was into looking into it, and I'm a researcher like crazy, and I just saw the focus on certification, third party sourcing, seed to sale, talking to the owners. It takes me a while to select anything, honestly.
Right.
If I'm going to do it, then my customers can do it. I don't bring anything in. I don't believe it. And so that took some time. And I know everybody in this industry goes through bumps. Like now there's a new, we're trying to get their veterinarians to open their eyes to it. We're looking at NASC certification, which means something to me. It's a national certification for manufacturers to do what they're saying they're doing. And somebody's checking, and you guys have that rating. So those are things that are important as this market, which is crazy, just keeps blowing up. So I'm grateful that luckily I did enough homework that I, you know, brought in a brand that has had the reputation. How is any comments on folks and their vets? Because I think here in Pennsylvania, they still can't maybe recommend it yet, but is there any movement coming to help make this more of a widespread protocol?
Absolutely. We definitely noticed that a lot of our pet or our pet parent customers that were calling in day to day, you know, even sent from you all, you know, give them a call, you know, they'll help answer those questions. You know, we talked to a lot of people who just want that green light from their vet, which we totally understand. I did not come from the pet industry, and by the Bible, I went through anything my vet told me. And so, you know, what our vets are saying is there's just not enough research yet, not enough data yet to fully give the information or recommendation to our pet parents that they are looking for. So we recognize that, and we actually brought on our new VP of development, came from Zoetis and Muriel, who are big pharmaceutical companies within the vet space. And he's issued the patent for both Frontline and HeartGuard, and there's another, I don't want to say the wrong one, but he has been working diligently to provide field studies to provide that safety and efficacy data that vets are looking for. So we've actually ramped up a new professional line to that would never, you know, compete with our loyal retailers, but really cater towards something a little bit more intense that people are going to their vets about anyways, to be able to offer that full spectrum hemp extract with some other active ingredients that are going to allow those vets to have that data that they need in feeling comfortable to talking more about hemp. And then all of a sudden they walk into Godfrey's and they're like, huh, that's the brand that my vet had recommended. And so, you know, we've even got another study going right now on osteoarthritis that's going to be published in the fall. And once that publication is out there, you know, it'll be, we'll be allowed to, you know, present to the VMA and hopefully be able to get some of this approved for those vets to then give that green light to our customers. So, you know, somebody's got to put out that research and that data. And that's something that we identified as kind of a hurdle from the get-go. So it's coming. It all takes time, you know, especially to do it the right way and to do it based off of, you know, following NASC guidelines. Yeah. When they had talked about the ingredient police earlier, you know, the NASC really helps regulate unregulated industries.
And
being able to make sure that we're being compliant and not, you know, overpromising and under-delivering and making false claims on our labels. We're testing our products not once, not twice, but three times now because of the NASC. And, you know, we're really making, we're held accountable. It helps us stay consistent. And, you know, that's huge. So again, you can go out and put out a product because again, nobody's really there to police that or pull it. But for us, you know, we're not just going to spend time on research and data and money on that research and data and production to then have it go pooled. You know, it's something that we're going to do the right way. And then eventually it'll be out there. And, you know, once regulation does come around, you know, it will pull some of those products off of the shelf probably aren't best.
Well, listen, we ran out of time. We're done. We could talk forever again.
I know.
I apologize. It was that slow technical start today that just got in our way. And I do apologize. We could have you back, can we?
Oh, please do. I mean, I can talk about CBD all day, and I appreciate even just the little bit of time to be able to talk about it more. But yes, thank you so much for being such a loyal retailer and having us and educating your consumers. I think that's amazing. So
welcome. Shelby, please come back. I think folks will love it. Maybe we can get some questions. We might be able to do a Q&A differently and do some of that. Education is a key. Good luck with your position. You're amazing. We really appreciate it.
Of course.
Thank you.
Yes. Have a great weekend.
Thank you. Bye-bye. Bye. I hope he didn't take us off already. He probably did.
Oh my God.
What? No,
I thought you were maybe doing a wrap up.
I didn't see the cards for Small Batch. I didn't see the cards for Shelby. Oh my gosh.
No, that's
okay. Want to do a few more? Do you want to do anything?
Sure.
Do you want to talk about? Go ahead. We have 4 minutes.
Let's see, what else do we have? So, you know, I know that with a lot of other, there's a lot of different types of products out there, and it can become hard for customers to really understand what products do I give my pet. So, you know, for us, we have a lot of different options, whether it be a baked good with an edibites, you know, there's sublingual tinctures that are best given, you know, all different absorption routes. So how it's absorbed into the body underneath the tongue, that's huge. But not every pet parent has such luck on giving that to their pets. So we also have you know, liposomal options where it's absorbed through the liver. So that way you can put it on food without being compromised by any food in the belly. And then we have capsules as well. And then topicals too. So, you know, great for external issues like hot spots, insect bites, post-op surgery wounds, stuff like that. So I always recommend our chews for the general maintenance or the easier to manage type issues like, you know, fireworks or thunderstorms or, you know,
car rides.
Yes. Pet parents going back to work. I mean, especially yes. These quarantine puppies that are just so used to their parents being home, and now all of a sudden, you know, they're not home anymore. It kind of freaks them out because they're thrown off their routine. It's great for that. Now, if they're struggling like with really intense nerves, then let's talk about a higher concentrate. You know, if they've been diagnosed with some kind of issue, you know, not that, again, kind of how Small Batch was saying, and this is not going to be the end all be all fix for everything, but can help support, you know, those harder issues to reach. And so there's something for everybody. So, you know, it's why it's important that we train our retailers. So when customers come into their stores, it's important that they know the right questions to ask, to deeper question and find out what the issue is, so we can kind of guide them in the right direction for what it is that their pet is actually going through and what product is going to be the best for their unique and specific situation. So a lot of options out there.
Yeah, there really are. And, you know, even with the treats, you know, there's different flavors and different special things they must have. I mean, like, it's perfect. Oh, yeah. That's where the discussion starts. There's no best food. There's no best. There's just, you know, we got to do pull it together for each individual dog, cat. Yeah.
And ingredients, too, you know. It shouldn't be like you have to stand in the aisle and Google every ingredient. You know, the nice thing is when you look at our products, it's like, oh, I've had all of that. So when people are like, oh my gosh, you've eaten an Edibite, and it's like, well, it's nothing that I haven't had before. It might not be as tasty as a snack that I would typically give myself, but, you know, there's benefits for me.
That's very true. That's so true. Yeah, you want to see ingredients we know and can eat. Yeah,
exactly.
And anything that we're doing with these, our guys that we want to live forever, you know? It's how it should be, absolutely. So, yeah, maybe we'll do another one with you. Okay, Shelby.
Yeah, I'd love it. Thanks so much, Barb.
And stay in touch and stay well.
Yes, you too. Have a great weekend.
Thank you. You too. Bye.
Bye.
There he goes.
Dog is Family on Berks Community Television is underwritten by Answers Pet Food.
Dog is Family on BCTV is supported by Godfrey's. Welcome to Dogdom.